Live. How are you doing this evening, brother?
I'm good. I'm concerned, but I'm good, and I'm happy to be here tonight.
Yeah, yeah. So we've got this hangout tonight where we are going to be covering the rapture like we've never covered it before, and just like it seems like with all the other things, the inversion is so 180 on this one. You know, it's hard to believe that it's been like 7 years and we haven't done this hangout yet, right?
Yeah, yeah. We've sort of alluded to it and talked about it in times, but never have we taken a deep dive into it.
Yeah. So we're going to be going through the origin of the rapture doctrine. And I think many of you might be surprised just how new and where it came from. This is not an old doctrine at all. And then we're going to be looking at the scriptures as far as, you know, could this be possible biblically and all that kind of stuff. But for me, just like with the, not the rapture, but the Trinity. So when you look at the origin of the Trinity, you get to see certain characters and you realize, okay, this is not where the truth would be coming through. It's not, and the same is true with the rapture doctrine. So we've sent this message out to a whole bunch of people tonight, all these rapture watchmen, and I really hope that a few of them will actually look into this and realize that it's very dangerous to be teaching false doctrine, right, with your eternal soul. It's very dangerous. So hopefully the word gets around to these guys, and maybe it'll sink into a few of them, right?
Well, you know, the thing is at the end of this day, at the end of this life, when we breathe our last breath, everything that we did, everything that we do, everything that we say, everything that we think is what's going to decide our eternal salvation, not whether we believed in, you know, the name Jesus even, right? We found that there's everywhere is deception. Everything that you could possibly think of has been inverted. The truth has been inverted in this reality. It's basically what Azazel has done. He's taken what is right and made it wrong. And what's wrong, he flipped it and made it right. So my call to all these rapture channels is a strong one and a serious one. And if I don't come out here and at least give my all and share what I know, then I'm going to be held accountable. So first off, if you're a YouTuber and you have 20, 30, 40, 50, 100, 300, 400,000 subscribers, and you're a part of this Bear Yaw, God a Minute, there's so many of these channels' names. If you think that you are being promoted to the top of the search engines because you're preaching the word of the Creator, you're going to have a rude awakening coming when the lake of fire is standing before you and there's angels throwing you into it, right? If you're selling merchandise, if you're out here profiting off of the word of the Creator, you're in deep trouble. You're in deep, deep, deep trouble. If you're not checking and back-checking every single thing that you're speaking about, if you're not having your friends and the people around you checking it, saying whether it's right or wrong and back-checking, you're seriously in a dangerous position, right? Everything that we hold tight to is back-checked. We've tried to debunk, and what we're left with is the truth. Jason, we don't have so says Yahawaha. He doesn't show up and tell us what to do. We trust in our pursuit of just pure truth. We don't have a stake in what is true, right? We don't go around teaching people that we live on a giant spinning ball, right? It's not real. It's not, there's no truth in it. We don't go around teaching people that the Christ's name is Jesus, because that means earth pig. We don't go around using the name God, because it's a pagan deity short form for the name Godreal, satanic name. Just those mere things alone have gave us pause. So what about this whole rapture doctrine? Right? If you look, you'll see that it's an entire industry where people are selling t-shirts and they have channels where all they do is talk about rapture being taken off the earth. What about the prophets that were sawn in half? How about all the apostles, being some of them being crucified upside down, some of them being flayed alive, boiled in oil? Why weren't they taken? How about Stephen as he was stoned to death? What is wrong with these people in the brain and in the heart? Where is the fear of Yahawaha? Where is the fear? And why is nobody opening up the books? Why are you not reading the scriptures? What is wrong with everybody on YouTube? My heart just cries out, what is wrong with these people? Do they not fear Yahawaha's judgment, Jason?
Apparently not, no. And it doesn't seem that people want to just do the independent research. And it's not that hard. I mean, we got Google now. I'm going to show everybody that if you do a Google search of where the rapture doctrine came from, you're going to get the information that we're going through tonight. It's not complicated or hard to find. So, but you have to have some sort of capacity to see when you're reading through the scripture, reading through the Wikipedia. If it says that this person was schooled at Trinity College and was a Jesuit and all these types of things, you have to be able to see that's not good, right? That's bad.
Yeah, well, how do people read in the scriptures that Christ, he didn't hurt a butterfly, he didn't hurt an ant. He went in and whipped the Pharisees and scribes who were selling the sacrificial animals inside the church. And how does someone think that it's okay to be selling a t-shirt that says Rapture on it? Or Jesus, or Yahawashai, when the letter V was invented at the same time as the letter J, merely 500 years ago, and they're going around saying they're prophets of the Creator. I mean, in the same things that happened in the Old Testament, these same things are happening right now. In the days of Sodom and Gomorrah, people thought it was great. Sure, give us the angels to rape, they said at Lot's door. Let us have our way with these men. We will rape them just like we rape the rest of the men. That's what's going on today. You got a bunch of filthy, disgusted people. They're running around pretending to be so-called Christians. And then Christ is going to come and he's going to say, I don't know you. And they're going to say, well, we prophesied in your name, Jesus. And he's going to say, that's not my name. Right? And I mean, do you think that Jason and I want to come out here? I don't want to have to yell and scream, but I'm terrified. I don't want to see people being thrown into the lake of fire. I want to say, Heavenly Father, I fought and did everything I possibly could. You know, if we could have some kind of supernatural ability to help us, it would really be needed, brother, because I mean, the way that it's going, if you look in the description box, I've tagged every single, they're all going to get a bell message from Awake Souls channel stating that this show is being broadcast. And you know, every single one of those people are profiting. They've got advertisements on their channels. They're profiting off of selling the rapture doctrine, that it's less than 200 years old. There is no such doctrine of being taken away, being caught up into the air. Okay, there's an explanation of what's going to happen when the entire earth, the face of the earth and all of the heavens is destroyed, right? There is a type of a catching up. This is going to happen at the very last day before the start of the millennial reign, because if everyone was to stay here on the face of the earth, they're all going to be utterly destroyed with everything else. But I just don't understand why it is that people are out here making a career off selling lies and disinformation. And at the end of the day, brother, what are they going to do? How are these people going to stand before the judge? I don't know what else to say. I'm terrified that if I don't come out here, like on Friday, I did a podcast and I went into the letter of Lentulus and it's a description of Christ. And one of my clamps fell down. You know, I prayed after that. Oh, please, Heavenly Father, if I'm in the wrong, because you're not going to get too many descriptions of what Yahawashai look like. Maybe there's a reason. So I live in fear of doing something that my father would not want me to do or say. Why is it that I don't see that in anyone else? I'm looking for it.
Yeah, I know. Here's a example. I think it was this morning, I got a comment on the what name will you use for salvation video. And so it was a comment of appreciation and thank you. So appreciative to have gotten this information. And so I had this good feeling in my heart that, all right, here's a person that appreciated finding out that Jesus and God are Vatican PSYOP names. But then at the same time, I'm thinking to myself, this is the first comment that I've received of somebody appreciating that video in maybe like a year. So I'm terrified to think of, okay, how many people out there are going to know the true name for salvation and how many are not? And so I'm thankful for everyone that would do the research and care. And then I'm scared for the lack of people saying that they even got it, that they even understand it. I mean, I don't know. It's, I don't know how to even comprehend there being so little interest in the truth. So the rapture doctrine, you go to a Watchman channel and guys like Barry and Aaron will have over 1,000 live viewers and everybody's, ooh, you know.
We love you. This is great. Oh, bless to you. Bless the God and Jesus and come, Jesus, come and all this stuff.
But as you're going to see tonight, it was made up by some Vatican puppets just not that long ago, really recent ago. And so I don't know. We'll see when the Great Tribulation begins. What we know from the scriptures is that the people that had the good righteous hearts, they're going to be marked. They're going to have a mark. They're going to be protected. And then all the people that don't have the mark of protection, they are going to just be losing their minds, because all of a sudden the judgments are going to start pouring out all around the world, and they're not going to be protected. And so the big difference between the rapture doctrine and what we talk about from the Bible is that here is the promise. Earth, this is where the kingdom is going to be. New Jerusalem is coming down to earth. This is our home. This is where we want to be. This going to heaven and, you know, sitting at the party table, getting married to Christ, this is false doctrine, and we're just going to point it out, and it's up to everybody to do as you will. Do as you wilt.
No. Well, your Father's kingdom come. Don't do as you're willed. No, beg the Father's will be done. You're hitting on all of the great points. Everything that they've completely inverted and messed up to these points where people think that they're the bride of Christ and they're some kind of a man child that's going to be caught up, and they're misinterpreting all the prophecies. They've got channels like Scotty Clark coming back and this Messiah 2030, and they're all yoking up together and just going over nonsensical circles where they're absolutely leading themselves and everyone else they follow into hell. There is no more good shepherds left. There's none more. The Book of Enoch expressed exactly how this was going to take place. And what we see is that as the Great Tribulation kicks off and starts to go, these people that are going to harden their hearts even further. There's not going to be any floating into the sky rapture. That's not scriptural. It's nonsensical Vatican Jesuit Azazel nonsense. And the people are going to get wicked. They're going to get more wicked. They're going to gnash their teeth. They're going to get more and more defiant. We can see these people mock the Creator. They sing songs. They put rapture helmets on because they think they're going to fly into the ceiling. They're going around pretending that they're fishing for fish. They're misinterpreting all of the heavenly signs. And not only that, almost every single one of these rapture channels are doing witchcraft gematria, where they go into some book because some Vatican Jesuit said the book has 66 books in the Bible, which there's actually like 350. So they count it and they put all these numbers to it. And then they start doing zodiac witchcraft nonsense where, oh, today is 522 days. And we go into this book and it says 522 and then rapture fish. And I'm going to tell you guys that every single one of these people, their tongues are going to be seared with the lake of fire. They're going to have to eat hot coals for eternity for these things that they're doing. And we've been telling them, and we've been tagging them, and we've been sending their messages. And what do? They block us. They come on and say, we mock them. Well, if you would come and sit down and have a conversation like men, we wouldn't have to call your wickedness out and expose it, because that exactly is what Paul told us to do. You do not become one with wickedness. You expose it, bring it out into the light for all to see. And all the people at YouTube that censor this content, for all the people that purposely don't stand beside us, that don't share this content, you too are also going to pay the price. Every single person that's watching this right now, that doesn't put in a comment, that doesn't want to stand with us, that goes back like a dog to its own vomit to go to Barry Oz channel, to go to God in a Minute's channel, to go to Steve Fletcher's channel, to go to, who are these people? Jerry Tooney. We could list every single one of you. Every single person that's in the chat, if you are going around preaching and supporting the rapture doctrine while these snakes and vipers go around profiting like this, what's his name? James. What's this guy's name that was at the slaughter of the lamb in Israel? And Leland Jones, if you know these characters and you're not telling them that they're in a very serious position, you two are going to stand with them. That's what scares me. And I want every single person that tunes in, that knows us, that watches our podcast, to be marked with a righteous stamp, that they search for the truth. And don't just listen to what Jason and I say. Open up the scriptures and read it yourself. For please, what more do you have to do? What more do you guys have to do than to do a Google search, like Jason said, and verify everything that we're saying? Do your own search. Don't trust us. But I'll tell you, if Jason says something that I don't agree with, I'm going to say to him, I don't agree with that. And then we're going to go through it until we both agree. And I want everyone else on the other side of the screen to also be marked and protected as someone that's going to be left here to inherit the earth, because this is the kingdom. The kingdom is before you and is going to be here for eternity. The kingdom is within you. It's not something that you can point to or see in the sky. The kingdom is something that's inside of you. It's what is the truth. And I'll tell you right now, the kingdom isn't about snakes selling rapture hats and rapture t-shirts and all of this other nonsense. You need to get as far away from that as fast as you can. As surely as the lightning comes from the east and the west, you cannot see where it actually comes from because it lights up the whole sky. That's how it's going to be. You have no idea what danger you're walking into. And I just pray that some of the people that I tagged are actually going to watch this and walk away from these clowns, get away from these charlatans, you know, bury, what was he selling, some Ponzi scheme fake water machine before he became a rapture doctrine teacher? He's like a witchcraft nonsense chiropractor who swore a Hippocratic oath. What does it say in the scriptures about not swearing oaths, Jason? What is wrong with people? And you know, sure, I sound a little bit upset right now. I'm going to give it back to Jason. This was a long rant. But if I don't come out here and say it, who else is going to? Who else is going to stand up for Yahawaha?
Yeah, no, good rant. Good rant. I think it's iridology is what Barry Yaw is into. So, yeah, from what we can see, he's just a Vatican mouthpiece. And so... All the false doctrine, all the secret societies, all the witches, all the wizards, all these
Pastor
people.
Pastor Sandy, sorry. There's more. We should name them all, but we can do it another time.
It all comes out of the Vatican. That's where all these false things come out of. So,
Who's that other channel? I found him today. You were unsubscribed. You know what's crazy? YouTube unsubscribes you. So YouTube took my channel down of almost 10 years and 6,000 subscribers and all my connections. But what was it? What's his name? Pastor Kim. So these rightly dividing Baptist Christian doctrines who believe that they have the word of the creator, these people are selling the rapture doctrine. I can't even believe exactly what Christ did when he chased the people out. And he chased those people out of the church because it was obviously a representation of things to still come. And here we are.
Yeah. Sorry, so no, that's all right. What do you say we get into the origins of the rapture doctrine?
After a song break, I hope. We need to take a breather here.
Absolutely. Yeah, so we'll see you on the other side, everybody, and we're going to get into the origins of the rapture. And we are back. We are going to find out, Left Behind or Taken, which one is better at Yahawashai's promised judgment? And so like the thumbnail tonight, Taken or Left Behind, which do you want? Which do you want? We're going to be going through some information tonight, and it's going to be up to you to decide which you want. Do you want to be taken or left behind? You with us, brother?
Yes, I am. I was just writing a comment to this chief truth somehow seeker, warning him not to talk unkindly to our moderator.
No.
It's not going to get him very far, or her.
Yeah, it won't go far at all. So, this is an article, and we cleaned it up. We put the right names in. So, for anybody that's not familiar with the true names of the Creator and the Christ, there's a couple videos on my channel. We've done all the research. It's been double-checked, verified by the people that follow this channel under a critical eye, right? So, when we say something, it gets critical scrutiny from a lot of people. And these are the actual names. Yahawashai for the Son, the Christ, and Yahawaha. There was no J or V 500 years ago. So if you're going to use a name that's got a J or a V in it, you're either ignorant or you are trying to deceive people.
I put it in the chat. We've just taken the Paleo-Hebrew characters. We've taken away the yods and all this other nonsense that the scribes and Pharisees added, and just put it back to the original pronunciations and names. But you're going to start with the Rapture tab, not the article. Are you just using this to reference Darby? So you got to explain to people where the Rapture first came from. It was your first tab. I don't see it.
This, I don't
see the right screen share.
This is the article that you wanted to go through, right?
After you go through your tabs, right?
Okay. I thought we were going through this first and then the tabs.
Other way around.
Other way around? Well,
go ahead. Start. Go ahead. Do your thing. I'll just be quiet.
Yeah, but this really sets the tone for all of it. So, John Nelson Darby, did you know that belief in a sudden rapture of the church at the end of time is a recent invention? John Nelson Darby, 1800 to 1882, created the idea to fit his belief that all Old Testament prophecies about Israel's glory days were going to come true for a future Hebrew nation on earth. The popularity of his rapture doctrine grew at the end of the 1800s and into the mid-1900s, because of D.L. Moody, Billy Sunday, and the Schofield Reference Bible. In less than 100 years, the idea went from unknown to a virtual litmus test for whether you believe what the Bible really says. How could people so quickly adopt this new idea into their doctrinal statements? Because Yahawashai and Paul talk plainly about being taken during a future judgment. Yahawashai says in Luke 17:34-35, I tell you, on that night there will be two in one bed, one will be taken, and the other one will be left. There will be two women grinding at the same place, one will be taken, and the other one will be left. It certainly sounds like some people will be whisked away during whatever judgment Yahawashai is talking about in Luke 17:22-37. If you trust the Bible's every word, how else could you read it? Before we adopt this recent idea about the end times, we should investigate what being taken and left behind means when the Bible describes a coming judgment. The New Testament isn't the first time these expressions were used. Mr. Darby might have misunderstood the meaning of taken and left behind by failing to read the language in the context of Old Testament prophecy. Unlikely that it was just a mistake. The messages of Luke 17:22-37. To find the right Old Testament context that informs Yahawashai's language in Luke 17, we must first understand the larger message that Yahawashai was delivering. Yahawashai begins his warning in Luke 17:22 by saying to his disciples, "The days will come when you will long to see one of the days of the Son of Man." Everything that follows is defined by his phrase, "the days of the Son of Man." Yahawashai's introductory expression alludes to decisive victories that military commanders won against their enemies. A day of the commander, or a day of the Lord, happens when a commander or lord deals a major blow to enemy forces. It means the good guys won against the bad guys. This common phrase from the ancient Near East shows up all over the Old Testament. Time and again, the day of the Lord describes one nation conquering another nation. Amos predicts a serious conquest of the 10 northern tribes of Israel in Amos 5. Zephaniah predicts Babylon's defeat of the Philistines, Moab, Ammon, Ethiopia, and Assyria in the day of the Lord's anger in Zephaniah 2. Ezekiel predicts Babylon's defeat of Egypt in Ezekiel 30. Isaiah predicts Persia's defeat of Babylon in Isaiah 13. In each scenario, the defeat of one nation by another nation is orchestrated by Yahawashai. Yahawashai is destroying a nation that has acted wickedly. He is punishing an enemy for their defiance. So the Bible describes these decisive defeats as a day of the Lord. In Luke 17:22 through 37, Yahawashai similarly uses the expression to refer to the coming destruction of a rebellious nation. Yahawashai compares the coming destruction to both the flood in Noah's day, Luke 17:26-27, and Sodom and Gomorrah in Lot's day, Luke 17:28-29. He says in Luke 17:30, "It will be just the same on the day that the Son of Man is revealed." People didn't expect the flood, but it happened suddenly. Sodom and Gomorrah thought everything was fine, but then they were caught off guard when disaster came. Yahawashai says the same thing is coming soon, at least after he suffers through many things and is rejected. That's from Luke 17:25. During that imminent destruction that Yahawashai is orchestrating, one will be taken and the other will be left. So what exactly does Yahawashai mean for someone to be taken and someone else to be left behind during the coming judgment? So left behind or taken in the Old Testament prophecy. Our first clue to interpreting Yahawashai's vague language is found in the flood story of Genesis. Genesis 7:23 summarizes the results of the flood this way. Yahawashai blotted out every living thing that was on the face of the ground, man and animals and creeping things and birds of the heavens. They were blotted out from the earth. Only Noah was left. What? Only Noah was left. And those who were with him in the ark. Being left out of this judgment was a good thing. Noah was promised to be left after the judgment. It meant he would escape death. Everyone else got killed. The same positive meaning for being left after Yahawashai's judgment continues through the Old Testament prophets' predictions of judgment. When Isaiah predicts the coming destruction of Israel, he gives reason to hope by noting that some people will remain. In that day, "The branch of the Lord shall be beautiful and glorious, and the fruit of the land shall be the pride and honor of the survivors of Israel. And he who is left in Zion and remains in Jerusalem will be called holy, everyone who has been recorded for life in Jerusalem." That's Isaiah 4:2-3. Those who are left and remain are the holy remnant. The rest who are taken away are unfaithful people whom Yahawashai is judging. Isaiah 3:1-3 explicitly predicts their removal during Yahawashai's coming judgment. See also Isaiah 39:6-7. "The time will surely come when everything in your place and all that your predecessors have stored up until this day will be carried off to Babylon. Nothing will be left, says the Lord. And some of your descendants, your own flesh and blood, who will be born to you, will be taken away. and they will become eunuchs in the palace of the king of Babylon.
So, you know, I hope everybody's starting to understand the language. I know we didn't quite go into the backstory of the beginnings of the rapture before we got into this, but what Jason's alluding to here, this is the expressions that were taken out of the Old Testament that clearly spoke of anyone that was being taken to destruction, to judgment, right? Whether it was to go into Babylon, whether it was to go into Egypt, right? Every single time that we had a left behind, it was somebody that was being protected and saved. The branch, the root was what was left, which was glorious and honorable. And it was everything that was taken was destroyed, right? So as you can see that they flipped, everything is completely inverted, exactly as the scripture said it would, that they would take what was good and make it bad and what was bad and make it good.
Yeah, I guess I could have gone through the other tabs first, but right. Here we are, we're into it. We're going through the whether or not you want to be left or taken. That, and then after this, we'll get into the origins.
We'll do it prequel style. It's fine.
Yeah.
I'm just people, because we're now into understanding as to the actual reasons why the rapture doctrine is incorrect. We didn't explain to you where it came from and what it actually is, but everybody should know what the rapture doctrine is.
So Jeremiah uses the same language to describe Jerusalem's coming destruction. Therefore, I am full of the wrath of the Lord. I am weary of holding it in. Pour it out upon the children in the street and upon the gatherings of young men. Also, both husband and wife shall be taken, the elderly and the very aged. Jeremiah 6:11. Everyone who is taken in this prophecy is experiencing Yahawah's judgment. In history, this judgment refers to the Babylonian invasion where Jerusalem was sacked. Many were killed and the rest were taken into exile in Babylon. You definitely wanted to be left out of that judgment.
So why do you think that there's all these YouTube channels being heavily promoted? They're being pushed to the tops of the algorithms. They've got thousands of live viewers and all of them are constantly talking about they want to be taken. They're begging. You've got all of these people, End Time Dreams Vision, Bob Guy and Barry On, all these guys, Steve Fletcher, they're just, what's Pastor Standy? Why do you think these guys are constantly wanting you to beg to be taken, right? It's because they're working for a spirit of wickedness. Azazel is in their heart. And what's happening is all of these people, all of these wicked, evil spirits are condemned. And what they, the only play that they have is try to condemn everyone else with them. That's the goal of this entire doctrine.
They're New World Order agents. They are Freemasons, Jesuits, Knights Templars, witches, wizards. They are anti-Christian, pretending to be Christian. They are wolves in sheep's clothing.
They come to you as a prophet of light when they're really absolutely just nothing but wicked and darkness.
And it continues here. In the Minor Prophets, we find two more examples of this language. Zephaniah describes how Yahawah will remove the wicked and leave a remnant of righteous people in Jerusalem after its judgment. In that day, you will feel no shame because of all your deeds by which you have rebelled against me. For then I will remove from your midst your proud, exalting ones, and you will never again be haughty on my holy mountain. But I will leave among you a humble and lowly people, and they will take refuge in the name of the Lord. Those who are left in Israel, Zephaniah 3:11.
And that name of the Lord right there is actually YHWH, right? In the Paleo-Hebrew, after each vowel was consonant was the ah sound, except for I. So it's Yah-ha-wah-ha. That is the name, not the name God, not the name Jesus, which means earth pig. And again, I want to point out before you scroll down, Jason, go figure Hollywood. Right, they made a movie called The Left Behind and they wrote the books and it was the most popularized, pushed to the top of the search algorithms. Everything that you see is completely inverted for a reason.
Yeah, so we don't sell any of this stuff. You can get some of these pictures, make it the screensaver on your phone or your computer or whatever. I want to be left behind.
Yeah, you want to be left behind, not taken. Everything that Hollywood has ever done and everything that any of these fake rapture channels are doing right now is leading you to hell.
It continues, Zephaniah makes it obvious which group you want to be in. The rebellious people will be removed, but the righteous will be left behind. The prophet Zechariah sends the same message to Israel. In the whole land, declares the Lord, two-thirds shall be cut off and perish, and one-third shall be left alive. Those who are left behind get to live while the rest die. The resounding message of the Old Testament prophets predicting judgment is Yahawah is punishing those who are taken and rescuing the people left behind. That paradigm should be the backdrop against which we interpret Yahawashai's words in Luke 17. Which judgment was Yahawashai predicting? If Yahawashai is using the same language as Old Testament prophets who predicted judgment, then what judgment was he talking about? The clearest clues come from Matthew 24, where the language about being taken or left behind from Luke 17 is also found in Yahawashai's prediction of Jerusalem's destruction. How similar are Luke 17 and Matthew 24? Both passages have the same surrounding analogies and promise of coming doom. 1. Yahawashai uses the same Old Testament analogy in Matthew 24:37-39 that is recorded in Luke 17:34-35. The events will be like Noah's flood. Both passages say the amount of death it causes will attract vultures to the center of the conflict. That's in Luke and Matthew. Both passages say the coming of the sun will be impossible to locate precisely. They describe the coming of the sun like lightning flashing across the sky. That's in Luke and Matthew, which means nobody can figure out exactly where it originated or where it went. Both passages begin by warning the disciples to avoid people who claim to know where the Messiah is. Luke and Matthew. Go ahead.
And that's not just talking about them pointing at a character. That's anyone that's opening up the scriptures and telling you who Christ is. His name is Jesus, and that he wants you to pray to be raptured. That is what this scripture is also alluding to. It's not just talking about that Christ was going to be walking across water and doing miracles in these days. It's about the people who are telling you the way to salvation, that if you pray this name, then you're going to be saved, right? When it's not true, you have to be, don't trust any man. You have to open the scriptures up and read it yourself.
Continues, it is imperative to note that Yahawashai describes deadly events that will happen around Jerusalem, but never claims that Christ will physically appear on earth. He commands his followers to get far away from Jerusalem. Let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Matthew 24:16. But they should not expect to find him somewhere at the coming of the Son of Man. If you assume the coming of the Son is some type of physical return to earth, rather than the plain meaning of the phrase all throughout the Old Testament, you will misunderstand what Yahawashai meant. Yahawashai is predicting another judgment coming upon unfaithful Israelites who rejected him, just like Isaiah and Jeremiah and many other Old Testament prophets did before him. He is not talking about his return to snatch people off of earth. The plain way to interpret his words, in line with the story of Scripture, is another coming of the Lord to judge. That is how we should read the language of being left while another is taken in Matthew 24:40-41. If people don't want to be taken or killed during that deadly event, they should get out of Judea immediately when the slaughter begins. When did Yahawashai say this coming judgment would happen in Judea? He does provide a general time frame with two bookends. He says it will take place after he suffers and is rejected by his generation. That's in Luke 17:25. He also says in Matthew 24:34 that this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. So the judgment is situated during the generation of Yahawashai's disciples after Yahawashai was gone, but before all of them pass away. With all those parameters, we can discern that the judgment Yahawashai predicted was carried out by Roman armies who invaded Israel and sacked Jerusalem in 70 AD. Just like Yahawah used Babylon to punish his unfaithful people in Jeremiah's day, he used Rome during the generation of Yahawashai's disciples. Yahawashai did not physically appear during the Roman invasion, just like Yahawaha did not physically appear during the Day of the Lord that Jeremiah predicted over 600 years earlier. The language of his coming was simply ancient Near Eastern shorthand for a decisive victory over his enemies. See Isaiah 19 for the Lord's coming against Egypt in judgment. All the people who rejected their Messiah around Jerusalem faced serious consequences for that decision.
And what do you think is going to happen to everybody that's going around using the name Earth Pig that is propelling this constant narrative that the Vatican's rapture is real, that you're going to be captured off the earth and float up into the air? You better put your hockey helmet on because Jesus is coming fishing. What do you think is going to happen when everybody, when this judgment comes, the next day of the Son of Man, which is coming very shortly? And this one isn't going to be like the last one. This one is the great day of Yahawaha, the greatest that has never been seen before. And as you can see, all of the truth is being exposed. It's all being brought out into the light. No one is going to have anywhere to turn to. There's not going to be a rock that's going to cover you. You are all going to be held out into the light for judgment. It's so close to right now. I don't know. It could happen at any flick of a moment. It could be here. And every single one of these people that have been selling t-shirts, selling lies, all of this stuff, like, I can't believe there's nobody here right now saying in the chat, yeah, I sell t-shirts. I'm one of these guys. There's nobody here. Where are these people? Where are they? You know, the father calls out, come to my supper. Oh, yeah, we're busy. We're over here teaching this false doctrine. What are these people doing? Where mm-hmm. are the people that rightly divide the scriptures? These Baptist people, all of these different people.
Yeah, so left behind was a good thing. For those of you who were not aware of the Old Testament prophetic language that Yahawashai used in Luke 17 and Matthew 24, you can now see that the judgment Yahawashai predicted isn't what you first think. Yahawashai's original Hebrew audience would have recognized the prophetic language. They would have wanted to be left behind after Yahawaha's judgment rather than taken during it. This scenario fits perfectly with Yahawashai's parables of coming judgment with the arrival of his kingdom. In Matthew 13:41-42, Yahawashai promised that the Son of Man would remove disobedient people from his kingdom. He explicitly describes the spiritual significance of removing the unrighteous and leaving behind the righteous. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of the Father. Matthew 13:43. The good guys will be left behind as the citizens of a new kingdom that all submitted to a new king, Yahawashai, enthroned in heaven. Just as Yahawashai spoke of the kingdom coming in Luke 17:20-21, before his prophecy of judgment, the coming of the kingdom of Yahawashai is not something that can be observed, nor will people say, here it is, or there it is, because the kingdom of Yahawaha is in you. It is among Yahawaha's faithful people who remain. It's time to correct the mistaken notion of a worldwide rapture of all Yahawaha's people in some futuristic doomsday scenario. No one is getting snatched off the earth in some surprising end-of-the-world scenario. Yahawashai's prediction of a historical judgment of his unfaithful people in the first century AD is the same kind of judgment that Old Testament prophets predicted before him, and it had the same purpose: eliminate the unfaithful so that those who remain could become the kind of people Yahawaha wanted everywhere in the world. His plan was to leave behind a faithful remnant that would represent his values in a loving community for all the world to see. I hope we are embodying that kind of kingdom today that our King gave his life to create on earth.
Yeah, no, we're not. No, we're absolutely as far as we possibly could be. And it's also spoken of not only in those scriptures that you referenced, but vehemently in the book of Enoch, that the wicked would be removed and the righteous ones are going to witness it all. They're not going to be snatched up into the sky. That's not what the scriptures state. Not at all. And this, we need to continue this. We're going to have much more to get into. This was just the opener. Jason's going to get into a bunch of tabs. We're going to look at more of this stuff so you can understand where the rapture actually came from. Now you see what the differences are between being taken and being left. Okay. There's never been a scripture that explained that you wanted to be taken ever until Darby invented it in the 1800s. There was never a prophet in the Old Testament that said that you were going to be spared and saved from anything. There's what kind of a creator do you think we serve? One that just won't make you. He sent his own son to be tortured and to die because of this wicked, vain world. You think that you're going to be saved? People really need to start looking into their own hearts and introspecting themselves, because I'm telling you, the coming destruction is on its way.
Yep. Well, that was a big read. So let's go ahead and take the song break. And then when we come back, we'll go through the tabs as far as the origin of the rapture. How's that sound, brother?
Sounds great.
With some Darby, some John Nelson Darby, the guy who came up with the rapture doctrine, right? So this is pretty simple, everybody. We're going to Wikipedia and we're gonna check this guy out. So John Nelson Darby, born 1800, he is considered to be the father of modern dispensationalism and futurism, pre-tribulation rapture theology was popularized extensively in the 1830s by John Nelson Darby and the Plymouth Brethren, and further popularized in the United States in the early 20th century by the wide circulation of the Schofield Reference Bible. So we'll be looking into Schofield next, but I just wanted to point out a few things about this guy. And so we go through here. Born in London, and so he went to school at Westminster and Trinity College, Dublin. So Trinity is a false Vatican doctrine, and so that's where he went to school. So at Trinity College, he was made a deacon and a priest and all this kind of stuff. Go through the middle years, and I've got some more highlighted stuff here. Where is it? This is later years. Do my highlights fall off? I don't think so. Alright. Darby has been credited with originating the pre-tribulation rapture theory, wherein Christ will suddenly remove his bride, the church, from this world to its heavenly destiny before the judgments of the tribulation. Thus, the prophetic program resumes with Israel's earthly destiny. Dispensationalist beliefs about the fate of the Jews and the re-establishment of the Kingdom of Israel put dispensationalists at the forefront of Christian Zionism. You have anything to say about Christian Zionism, brother?
Yeah, it's gross. It's nothing but nonsense and occupiers that are headed for destruction, really.
Well, and it's also an oxymoron, right? You can't...
Yeah, you can't have a Christian Zionist, right? Christ was against Judaism. He was here to destroy it. He fulfilled everything that needed to be fulfilled, right? Not doing away with being righteous. He came and led the way to show how the true righteousness was. And he said, if you don't exceed these people with their righteousness, these Zionists, right, they're going to be destroyed. So you better be doing something more righteous than them. For what they trusted in their law, and they died from it.
Yeah, so if you're a Zionist, you can't be a Christian. If you're a Christian, you can't be a Zionist. Mutually exclusive.
It's an oxymoron.
All right, let's go on to Schofield here. So Schofield is, he's the guy that put together a reference Bible. So... was an American theologian. He came around in 1843, a theologian, minister, writer, who best-selling and annotated Bible popularized futurism and dispensationalism among fundamentalist Christians. So he's got a Bible that he put some stuff in the notes. He's got notes on the page, and then these notes taught these doctrines. He's from Michigan. Then he actually moved. He was in Texas and Toronto and all these. He stepped on our ground. Let's see, there was. So this is Civil War time. He was. Where is it?
A defector.
Yeah, a defector. Schofield deserted and escaped. Taking the Union Oath of Allegiance.
That was loud. Taking that oath.
Mm-hmm. Lawyer and politician. And it says here, nevertheless, that same year, Schofield was forced to resign under a cloud of scandal because of questionable financial transactions, which may have included accepting bribes from railroads, stealing political contributions intended for Ingalls, and securing bank promissory notes by forging signatures. It is possible Schofield was jailed on forgery charges, although there is no extant evidence in the public records. Perhaps in part because of his self-confessed heavy drinking, Schofield abandoned his wife and two daughters during this period. Lenentine Chair Schofield divorced him on grounds of desertion in 1883, in the same year Schofield married some other broad. So, one of the things you got to ask yourself, we've got two guys so far that are, they are the fundamental grassroots of the rapture doctrine. And here, this one, this guy is, he's a thief, he's a fraud, he's a heavy drinker, he neglected his wife and daughters, and so this is one of the guys responsible for the rapture doctrine. If you look at the character of the guy, do you really think that this guy was being used to bring about some secret hidden mystery doctrine in the Bible? Or does he look like he's a New World Order fraud? Because if we keep going here, he served as the secretary of the St. Louis YMCA, that is Young Men's Catholic Association. The C is for the Catholics. And let's see, he traveled around. So this guy got loaded up with money for having published this Bible. Then he gets to travel the world and sell his rapture doctrine everywhere. Mentions that he also joined the prestigious Lotos Club. All right. The Lotos Club. Take a look here. Notable members. You've got the Astors. You've got the Carnegies. You've got the Chryslers. You've got Eisenhower. You've got Hearst he was a big, super rich guy in media. You've got Charles Schwab. And this is the club that he was in. Can you see that this is all Freemasons? The first one of the big names in it was Mark Twain. Very clear, obvious Freemason. All right, so the two characters behind the rapture doctrine are the guys that run in this group right here. I just want to point out to everybody, this is so easy. Just type into Google, when was the rapture doctrine introduced? So the next couple tabs I'm going to be going through here are from right here. Very simple. Not hard to find this information. And I think it's sort of unique that this one right here, we're going to be using an article from CNN. I didn't expect this, but it's pretty decent. It says it pretty plainly. Even Jesus, no, it's not Jesus, Yahawashai wouldn't buy the rapture. So, CNN. HBO has just launched a new TV series based on a novel by Tom Perrotta called The Leftovers, which in turn is based on the fundamentalist Christian idea of the rapture. Apart from the title, which suggests a refrigerator full of stale food, the series looks promising. It's a terrific premise. Yahawashai returns and calls to heaven 140 million people, leaving behind billions of stupefied, confused, and grief-stricken others. In the show, a mother loses her baby, who disappears. A boy's father seems to have vanished as he pushes a shopping cart. Cars collide as drivers go missing. Chaos strikes in the fictional Mapleton, New York, and throughout the world. How to cope? The famous Left Behind series by Tom LaHaye and Jerry B. Jenkins was already out there. It consisted of 16 best-selling novels on the same premise and is about to come to the big screen again in a film starring Nicolas Cage. I don't know what's going on with my mouse. The original film adaptation of 3 appeared in 2000. And then there is the Christian real-time strategy video game called Left Behind, Eternal Forces. If anyone hasn't noticed, the rapture has become a commercial juggernaut, endlessly shape-shifting, finding new and highly entertaining outlets. And that's what the Barry Oz are doing, is capitalizing on this, trying to sell it. What about the theology behind this industry? The rapture notion goes like this. Yahawashai is coming back, and when he does, he will return before a time of so-called tribulation begins, calling up into the clouds with him those who are saved. Horrible suffering will then occur on the miserable earth for 7 years. Then Yahawashai will come yet again for a final judging. There are many different versions of this scenario, so it's difficult to summarize. It's fair to say, however, that only fundamentalist Protestant churches bother to think about the rapture at all. Catholics discount the idea completely. They made up the rapture, everybody. The rapture concept is relatively new. It started with an Anglo-Irish theologian who in the 1830s invented the concept. This may come as a shocker to many, but it's a fact. Before John Nelson Darby imagined this scenario in the clouds, no Christian had ever heard of the rapture. The idea was popularized by Cyrus I. Schofield, an American minister who published a famous reference Bible in 1908, one that developed the idea of an elaborate series of final periods in history known as dispensations. Schofield, like Darby, read the Book of Revelations as a vision of the future, not a fiery dream of the destruction of Jerusalem by the Romans in AD 70. The latter view remains, in fact, the most common interpretation of the Book of Revelation by mainstream theologians, and was described recently by Princeton scholar Elaine Pagels in Revelations, Visions, Prophecy, and Politics. It's a problem, however, for rapture-minded Christians that the word rapture doesn't appear anywhere in the Bible unless you're willing to think it broadly, metaphorical terms. Rapture thinking is most often traced back to the Apostle Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians, where he writes, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout of command, and with the voice of an archangel and the trumpet of Yahawaha. The dead in Christ will rise first, then we, who are left alive, will be snatched up with them on clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we shall always be with the Lord." That's the 1 Thessalonians 4.
It's the only scripture that they have.
That's all they got.
It's the only one that they go to, and they take it all out of context, and they don't exactly read before and after it either.
Yeah, so I think my next article has got context to that. Let's see here if there's anything else important from the CNN article. So this just sort of goes to the commercialization of this rapture doctrine.
Mm-hmm. How it's an industry.
It's an industry. And here we've got the rapture, a popular but false doctrine. And some of the things that I highlighted from here. It says the rapture was popularized in the 1970s. I mean, this is when I was born. This is not, I mean, it's sort of long ago if I'm old, but it's not too long ago. So Hal Lindsey's writings, The Late Great Planet Earth, right? So it's just false doctrine upon false doctrine here. And more recently by Jim Jenkins and Tim LaHell. Go ahead.
So let's take a second here. So everybody who is getting popularized, maybe the younger generations don't know, but the movies The Left Behind by Jim Jenkins was the largest disinformation campaign PSYOP that was put upon our generation, right? Everybody saw the movies. Who was it? Kirk Cameron played the reporter that went to Jerusalem that interviewed the two witnesses. And so what we have is we have Jim Jenkins' son, Dallas, who was the film director of the TV movie, or no, he became even smarter than his dad, the Chosen, right, is where they blasphemed a bunch of the truth as well. The Chosen is Jim Jenkins' son, Dallas Jenkins, here and he's in Dallas, right? He's in Texas. And it's blasphemous as well. So the same crew is continuing on, but now it's his son. So everybody does know the Left Behind trilogy, right? I think they have three or maybe four. I can't remember. I think there was three versions of it. Now we have The Chosen, right? Which wasn't so centered around the rapture. It was centered around Christ Day. But there's a lot of this misinformation. They made Matthew out to be autistic, and they blasphemed in a bunch of ways. But I just wanted to point out that Jim Jenkins is the father of the guy who did the show The Chosen, who is Dallas Jenkins' son. And Dallas Jenkins actually had everybody pay for the show. He called it Pay It Forward. He had everyone donate so that he got, and he sold the show
to a TV company called, was it Angel Productions nonsense? So I just want everybody to understand that this is super heavily indoctrinated into the people, and it's all straight from the pits of hell. All of this rapture talk, all of this doctrine is straight from the pits of hell.
Yeah, so everywhere you go, you're going to hear that John Nelson Darby was credited for inventing the rapture doctrine. There's a couple of big words that they use around this. It's post-millennialism, amillennialism, and premillennialism. So this is what everybody argues about. We're not going to go through it in this article. I've got some other things highlighted here. So Schofield picks it up. Darby's pre-tribulational view of the rapture was then picked up by a man named C.I. Schofield, who taught the view in the footnotes of his Schofield Reference Bible, which was widely distributed in England and America. Many Protestants who read the Schofield Reference Bible uncritically accepted what its footnotes said and adopted the rapture doctrine, even though no Christian had heard of it in the previous 1,800 years of church history, and that's coming from Catholic.com. All right. So, I mean, you got the Catholics mocking the fact that this is just a brand new out-of-nowhere doctrine. And so the thin proof, this right here, for such a seemingly major doctrine, I mean, if this is really our hope, if you're a Christian, if this is your hope that to be caught up, raptured before the Great Tribulation, here's from the Schofield Reference Bible. Remember, it's the footnotes that taught this. We're going to see what scriptures are in the footnotes. So this is the 1970 edition. Caught up, not church saints only, but all bodies of the saved, that is, not only the living, but also the dead, of whatever dispensation are included in the first resurrection. It is particularly the blessed hope of the church. Matthew. And so this is the, I mean, when it says thin proof, this is what you have to go by if you're going to believe the rapture doctrine. This is what he gave. I mean, we got a little bit of time here. Let's see what Matthew 24:42 is, right? We'll bring that up. Watch therefore, for ye know not what hour your Lord doth come. Therefore stay awake, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. So you too must keep watch, for you do not know what day your Lord is coming. All right, that's
not rapture proof.
That's the proof. That's the proof of the rapture.
Do your work. Stay awake. Stay sober. Constantly do the research. Continue to read the scriptures over and over again. Line upon line is what it's telling you to do.
Well, we'll see what his next proof scripture is. Watch therefore, for ye know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh.
Again, that was alluding to judgment, not to Christ walking on water and rising people again from the dead. That's not what they were saying.
All right. So far, the thin proof is looking even thinner now. Let's see what he's got in Luke.
Which no one knows, as sure as the lightning comes from the east as it is seen in the west.
You know, like servants waiting for their master to return from a wedding banquet, so that when he comes and knocks, they can immediately open the door to him. It will be good for those servants whose master finds them watching when he comes. Truly I tell you, he will dress himself to serve, will have them recline at the table, and will come and wait on them. It'll be good for those servants.
Hold on. This, we got to slow down.
Yeah.
Let's look a little closer at what this is saying. Start again at 37, please.
It will be good for those servants whose master finds them watching when he comes. Truly, ooh, I tell you.
Go ahead.
You can read it too, brother.
No, I want you to do it. I'm sorry.
He will dress himself to serve, will have them recline at the table, and will come and wait on them.
So what does that mean? What do you think that means, Jason?
Well, he's talking about, so we all know, here's the modern day.
I don't want to get too deep.
Yeah, when
I'm not,
you want to
reveal what,
when your boss yeah. shows up, right?
Yeah.
You don't want to be slacking. You don't want to be hanging out in the corner smoking a spliff. You want to be, mm-hmm. you know, doing what you're supposed to be doing when your boss shows up.
Well, it's not even only that far. He's saying he's telling you that Christ is going to dress himself as a servant. He's going to come and serve on you to see how you treat him. So you don't know where he's going to come from. You don't know. It's not going to be there. It's not going to be here. This is a grave warning. This is a grave warning that people should look into. People, I really wish there was more people searching the scriptures out, because it's clearly showing it'll be good for those servants whose master, when he comes to serve on you, you tip him well, and that you clean up your own plate and that you thank him, right? Be careful of what you're doing, because you don't know if he's going to come in the day or a night. You don't know. No one knows. But he's clearly telling you that he is going to come and test you. And you're not going to know, because he's going to be a servant. He's not going to be the boss rolling in the big dually truck. It's going to be the guy cutting the grass. You're not even going to get it. I'm terrified.
It will be good for those servants whose master finds them ready, even if he comes in the middle of the night or toward daybreak. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him. Peter asked, Lord, are you telling this parable to us or to everyone? The Lord answered, Who then is the faithful and wise manager who the master puts in charge of his servants to give them their food allowance at the proper time? It will be good for that servant whom the master finds doing so when he returns. Truly I tell you, he will put him in charge of all of his possessions. But suppose the servant says to himself, My master has taken a long time in coming, and he then begins to beat the other servants, both men and women, and to eat and drink and get drunk.
And sell t-shirts and rapture hats and YHVHs and Jesus is Lord and Adam and Eve lost it. Are you guys paying attention? The scripture is exactly talking about what we're seeing today.
The master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him, and at an hour he is not aware of, he will cut him to pieces and assign him a place with the unbelievers.
Cut him to pieces. Ooh.
Yep. The servant who knows the master's will and does not get ready or does not do what the master wants will be beaten with many blows. But the one who does not know and does things deserving punishment will be beaten with few blows. For everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded. And from the one who has been entrusted with much, much more will be asked.
Very so, important.
Did this prove the rapture, in your opinion?
No. Do we have any more?
Yeah. There's Acts 1:11. All right. This is, I don't know how people even came to the conclusion, right? Men of Galilee, they said, Why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Yahawashai who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven.
And so what do you guys think that that means? How did every single person that has ever been in this reality get here, Jason?
Born in.
They were born, right? Through what? The water of their mother's womb, right? That's what they were telling him. And not only that, but Constantine in the Great Crusade was actually going around and they were murdering anybody who was teaching the truth of reincarnation. That surely it is if you die that you will be born again. That it's not some splash on water. And that's a whole other scripture study that we'll be getting into in another time period.
So we got Philippians.
We have to stick at one topic at a time.
But our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, Lord Yahawashai, who, by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control, will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body.
So let's look at this in a simple term, okay? What we want to be asking for right now is a righteous heart that follows the path of truth, that are ready to serve, to do the jobs, to stand out here and to talk about the truth in the face of not being popular, not getting involved with the selling of the t-shirts and getting the hundreds of thousands of views, but actually doing the work of teaching the truth and digging in the scriptures like we are commanded to do. And the glorious body, the vesture, the clothing that the Creator gives you is like what you're understanding. It's a parabolic language for your belief in him and the things that you hold true, and he puts that on you. And we will be given perfect bodies. We'll be all in the kingdom 30 years of age, except for those that are born after that. And we're not going to have any more pain or suffering. And that will actually take place at a twinkling of an eye, right? This is where the scriptures, that the rapture doctrines, they're just barely clinging to any truth. And there's no truth to what they're saying.
And here's his last reference scripture. So Titus 2:11-13, for the grace of Yahawah has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great Elohim and Savior, Yahawashai. So yeah, this
got a bunch of nonsense tied into one.
Yeah, so the blessed hope is actually something that's going to be coming up, I think, in this article now. So might be a little bit farther along. But it says here, some rapturists today cite Acts 8:39, saying it uses the same Greek word that is translated caught up in 1 Thessalonians. They say that the fact that the spirit of Yahawah caught Philip away shows that 1 Thessalonians means that the saints are caught away to heaven. Yet the spirit did not transport Philip to heaven, but rather from one place on earth to another.
Yes.
Right?
I believe Ethiopia? I don't know if that's the correct one. There's a bunch. We'll get into that another time.
No, so here's the blessed hope section. And I think this is really important because once a person learns this blessed hope thing, it's an easy way to spot a Vatican Satanist, right? The words blessed hope also often appear in rapture literature. In fact, the blessed hope is the name by which some denominations refer to the rapture doctrine. They take blessed hope from Titus 2:13, where Paul writes, looking for the blessed hope in the appearance of the glory of our great Elohim and Savior, Yahawashai. So the implication is that the word appearance conveys something secretive and sudden, that is the rapture. Therefore, blessed hope becomes a sort of shorthand for the rapture in literature and films on the doctrine. So when you see all these YouTube channels and their channel name is the Blessed Hope and everything is Blessed Hope this and Blessed Hope that, that's just a Vatican shorthand for the rapture doctrine. So flawed foundation. You know, the word rapture comes from Latin rapire, meaning to seize or abduct. The Greek verb for caught up is harpagasomethia. Does it convey the sense of an abduction here? No. It combines the ideas of force and suddenness seen in the irresistible power of Yahawah. Why would Paul use such a strong word? Let's allow the Bible to speak for itself. The context of the subject begins in verse 13 and concludes in verse 11 of the next chapter. Paul wrote this section of the letter in answer to concerns from the local Christians. Remember, this is a letter to a congregation that has concerns. As you read verse 13, you discover that Christians in Thessalonica were grieving over the unexpected deaths of members of their congregation. Albert Barnes comments, "There seems some reason to suppose that some of them believed that though those who were dead would indeed rise again, yet it would be long after those who were living when the Lord Yahawashai would return had been taken to glory and would always be in a condition inferior to them." All right, so this is commentary on where the question from the Thessalonians is coming from. So they were concerned about, whether or not the resurrected were going to be of the same glory or if it would be a reduced glory. All right, so Paul wrote that they should not grieve over this, for if we believe that Yahawashai died and rose again, even so, Yahawha will bring with him those who sleep in Yahawashai, believers who had died. Verse 14. Was he responding to a worry about whether Christ would rescue believers from the Great Tribulation? No, nothing is said of this. So, the context. It's a reunion with friends who died. Paul's reason for using such a strong word as harpagesomethia was to reassure people that at Christ's return, Yahawha would reunite believers who remain alive with believers who had died. The dead won't be behind in any way. Boom, that's it. All right, so the context around the scriptures, it's not about skipping the Great Tribulation. And I've got one more we can take a peek at. This is from Catholic.com, right? These are the guys that are behind all the false doctrines. The Pope, good chance it's going to be the, there's the
false prophet,
right? The Vatican is Mystery Babylon. It's going to be annihilated. So their article, the first paragraph is funny. Are you pre, mid, or post? If you don't know how to answer that question, you're probably a Catholic. Right?
Ridiculous.
Yeah. So they go into an explanation of what the millennium is, what post-millennialism is, amillennialism, premillennialism, and the rapture. All right, so I think we've gotten a pretty good understanding of what the rapture is. And then let's just take a look at what the Catholics' position is. As far as the millennium goes, we tend to agree. So I tend to agree. There's no authoritative answer whatsoever with Augustine and derivatively with the amillennialists. The Catholic position has thus historically been amillennialism, as has been the majority Christian position in general, though Catholics do not typically use this term. The Church has rejected the premillennial position, sometimes called millennialarianism.
Millennialarianism.
So in the 40s, the Holy Office judged that premillennialism cannot safely be taught, though the Church has not dogmatically defined this issue. So the Vatican, who created the rapture doctrine, also won't teach it because they know.
And they let the Christians do it, the Baptists and all these other guys. That's who does it.
Mm-hmm.
Lutheran and all these other types of denominations.
Yeah, so there's your origins of the rapture, everybody. And we looked at the proof for it from the Schofield Reference Bible. And I don't buy it, brother. I don't buy it.
No, I'm terrified that anyone is teaching it, selling it, profiting off of it. No wonder that all these people that I've tagged in the description box and then also be in a comment are some of them are 300,000 subscribers.
right? 10,000, 5,000, 20,000, 15,000 in every single video, like you see from God a Minute, is him fishing, rapture this and rapture that. Yet they don't talk about anything else in the scripture. Nothing. Mm-hmm. Mary Ah, same thing. Everything he goes through. Pastor Sandy, who's an hour, he stands there with the star of Rembrandt, Molag star. Like every single one of these people that you'll see, this other James character, every single one of these guys is just the same thing over and over again. They're going to fly up into the sky. They got to put rapture helmets on. They create these retarded characters as they go around mocking the truth, mocking the Christ, mocking the Savior. And no wonder they're being pushed right to the top. Everybody gets it. If you don't click, turn off the next video algorithm player on the, you get straight to their videos, right? They're being completely pushed and selled by the New World Order Antichrist system. And we're here to document it, to tag it, to title it, to make sure that you guys know, the people that tune into our channel, that come for truth, that you're armed with the truth. So you can stay as far away from all this blasphemy, from all this stuff, so that you will be left here to inherit the kingdom of heaven with us, so that we can live in a righteous world where all these people are going to be destroyed. They're headed for, I don't want Barry Ott to be destroyed. He's a pretty funny guy. You know, Aaron's probably a good hockey player. Pastor Sandy looks like he can lift some damn weights. He looks like a pretty strong guy. These guys could be useful in the kingdom, but they're not going to be there. They're going to be taken off for destruction. They're going to get snatched up, but it's not going to be by the angel that they think, right? Mm-hmm. And we don't want you to be snatched up by those angels either. We want you to stay here and to learn the truth with us. That's the most important thing. Please, you guys, open up the scriptures and read them. Read the books. You don't even have to read them. We live in the greatest time alive. You can, every single night I go through scripture after scripture and I have them read to me when I wind down. You don't even have to read the words. You can listen to it. You can fall asleep to it. You can study it. You can also read it. You remember it the most when you read it out loud. And that's why we do this. Jason, you did a great job tonight. I was thankful that you did this study. You put the words together. You put the correct names in. We took the God and the earth pig out. And we brought you the true names, YHW, YHWSHI. We want you guys to have the correct truth, right? We don't want to be selling anything. And check everything that we say. If you think, you know, if Dallas Jenkins isn't the son of that Jim Jenkins and the Lost, the Left Behind saga moved on now, it's called The Chosen, right? The Chosen. Next thing you know, it's probably going to be rapture stuff too out of that camp. I don't know. I'm terrified. I'm terrified that Yahawaha isn't walking around here right now judging us all, with it, the next person that comes to cut your grass isn't the Christ secretly in there checking on your heart, right? What are you going to do if you end up in the judgment seat and he's like, well, I was right there, I stood right beside you, you blasphemed me, right? How are you guys going to deal with that? I don't want to be beside anybody, and that I want to be right here on earth when the kingdom comes down and we are to celebrate for eternity together, at least for 1,000 years. And we're headed that way, so try not to get too down on yourselves. I know that we give thanks and we do our prayers. We make sure in the morning when you get up that you pray the Father's will be done. And when the sun sets, you also pray the Father's will be done, because there's an accounting of that too. The angels go up to Yahawaha and they report everything. And the more righteous you are, right, the more sober-minded you are, the more beautiful-hearted you are, the more you're out trying to help other people and being kind and lifting other people up, the more the Holy Helper can actually come and dwell inside you. And that is what you need to get into the kingdom. More of the Holy Helper inside you and less of selling t-shirts and hats and false fake doctrines. I pray in my heart that everybody tunes in actually is lifted up from the truth. Sometimes the truth is bitter. We eat it, it might be sweet. Sometimes we eat it, it's bitter. But then after that bitter goes down, it heals us. It takes time. So just keep at it, you guys. And I hope that Aaron and Barry and Sandy and all these other characters, this whole team on the other side of the screen, repent. Turn away from this wicked nonsense right now. Do it as fast as you can. Come out with your videos. Repeat and tell all of your viewers that you were wrong. And that you don't want to burn in hell for selling t-shirts and hats and having them all go around with the wrong doctrine on their bodies too, because you're all going to be held accountable for each and every character that you led wrong. I beg you that you all turn from your wicked ways as soon as possible.
Yeah, so we will be live again this Friday night because it's first Passover, right? This whole crew, every single one of them, well, there's actually one of them that broke rank and is actually admitting the truth, Javette or something like that. But yeah, so first Passover, this May 5th, it's a there's a blood moon, which is a lunar eclipse, and it's first Passover. They're going to be saying second Passover. So we're coming into the season, people. It's starting to happen. We know that the real trumpet is going to be marked by a American eclipse, but these fake rapture watch false doctrine guys, the ones that are saying that it's second Passover, they won't be able to say that eclipse is marking trumpets because they're an entire month off. So
right, and then the eclipse after that, celebrating tabernacles, will be another lunar eclipse that they'll miss as well.
Mm-hmm. So we're getting into it, everybody. We'll see what 2023 has to offer. It does look like this could be the final Shemitah, right? The last 7 years, the Great Tribulation, and then the 6,000 years will be complete.
The 120th Jubilee.
Mm-hmm.
And make sure you tune in on the Limitless Channel Friday morning for the Rise and Grind podcast. We'll go through the news. We're going to do a little bit of other studies too. It's going to be great. We got a lot of stuff to go over. That's going to be at 7 a.m. Central Time on the Limitless Channel, the one you see in the chat and in the comment section below. Make sure you tune in for that. And then at nighttime, yes, we are going to do the bread and wine celebration, which is goes right back to Adam and Eve and Michael and Yahawaha. This is the covenant. Michael brought Adam the bread because Adam was starving when he had fallen. And, you know, we give glory unto Adam and Eve, for if they had not fallen, none of us would be here, and the glory of the Christ and his sacrifice would have never taken a place. We don't bash and say that Adam and Eve lost it. We say that they gained eternal life through what happened, the entire scriptures. And I'll try to come up with something beautiful that we can have a small study, and we can, you know, do the bread and wine covenant together. I'm really looking forward to Friday night, brother, but you did a great job tonight. I hope everybody was edified with the truth. Please leave comments below. We don't get anybody that wants to stand beside us, and I'm terrified that the Father is not doing this work, and that when he's going to hold everyone accountable. You know, I feel so grateful that the people that are here in the chat that show up regularly, that support, that want to share this truth, yours is the kingdom of heaven. You're going to inherit it. I know it. I know that because Jason and I, we don't have any stock in this. We're not selling anything. Our channels aren't monetized. We don't make any money. We don't want any money. We are all about the truth. And there's such a small, tiny, tiny, do we have 12 people, brother? Is there 12?
No, I don't know if there's that many.
Well, I just all the time, you know, I'll do this publicly. I beg the living Father of creation, help us send more people that want the truth, because I'm terrified. I don't want to go into the kingdom alone. I want there to be a group of, you know, it is prophesied that there is going to be more, and I don't know how else Yahawaha has to do this work. We need help. And I just pray that you're all lifted up from this truth. And it might not be fun to listen to. This isn't a beautiful, like, we're going to go home and everybody's going to... It's the truth, right? And thank you, brother, for taking this time tonight.
Yeah, it's been great. And we will see you all on the true Passover this May 5th.
Amen.
Yes. The only place you're going to hear any of this information, everybody, is where, brother?
Yahawashai News Networks.
No map and no bearing. where the thief of the sun still covets the day. Sky to lure and to tempt, saying I am the tempest and I am your way. But the faintest have signals through static, through noise, a drifting transmission, a shimmer of set course by the sound, through veil and divide, for all who are lost can always be found. In brilliance arise, and in vastness ignite, a torch of your purpose, spirit unites. Set course by the signal, when day's glimmer fades, where all of the stars seem so far away. But the faintest have signals.